If you are receiving this transmission, you are the resistance declaring war on the New World Order. TruthRadioShow.com. Shalom and welcome to TruthRadioShow.com and welcome to a Bible comprehensive study, an in-depth Bible comprehensive study of the Bible and 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And I'm your host, Dan Bedondi, and welcome here to the broadcast. So what we do is we do a specific Bible study approach. And by the way, if you missed chapters 1 through 2, I would stop right here and go listen to those chapters before you go any further. This way you can hear the instructions of how we actually do things. So I always address this mainly at the start of every book. I try to do it every chapter, whatever the case, keep people reminded that we don't just skim through the Bible by just reading it. We actually study in deep context as we can get. Pull out all the meat and potatoes out of these verses so you get a full understanding of this. So, like always, we get this Bible study approach. It's awesome to do this because this is how you gain the spiritual applications of the Bible. Now, this is something that not even academia can understand. People with scholars and all these degrees and all that, this is something they can't even comprehend. To gain the spiritual applications of the Bible is through the spiritual understanding of it. And that's only through the Holy Spirit that can teach that, better than any professor or so-called scholar in the world combined. So let's pray for wisdom and understanding. So what we do is we get ourselves right with the Lord. And by doing that, we pray to you, Yeshua, Jesus, we love you so much. We ask you to forgive us all individually, the sins and trespasses, transgressions or abominations that any one of us may have committed. And we ask and plead for your blood to cleanse us, Lord. Cleanse the filth out of our hearts. Cleanse the dirtiness from us, Lord. And just help us just get through these days that, sin's thrown at us left and right. And we pray that you can help us resist sin and resist transgression in the law. And we love you so much, Lord. And we ask you to, again, anoint us with your precious blood. And Heavenly Father, we come before you and ask you to give us the fire of the Holy Spirit. To anoint us and baptize us in the fire of the Holy Spirit. And to give us the Holy Spirit as a great comforter. And to help, to have the Holy Spirit write your word upon our hearts today, in this case, the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And comfort everybody that needs comfort, Lord. And just we ask you for deliverance, Lord, that anybody's going through any demonic infestation or aggression, anything like, being plagued by any evil spirits, we ask you to just deliver all of us from the forces of evil and protect us all from the forces of evil. And we love you so much. In your mighty name we pray, amen. And we read the scripture in context because context is key. This is a big, 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 big thing we have to do. Read the scripture in context. Don't jump all over the Bible when you do a Bible study. I mean, it's good to make reference here and there, but don't frog hop all over the Bible. Read the chapter. Read the chapter straight through and without jumping all over the Bible. And let the scripture interpret scripture. In other words, let the Holy Spirit interpret it for you. So let's open up 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And thank you, ShakeAndWakeRadio.com, for carrying us on your awesome audio network. And if you're listening on ShakeAndWake.com, I would strongly suggest for you to open up your own Bible. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And those of you on our YouTube channel, we got it right up on screen here. And this is this broadcast will soon become the Rumble. So I decided to open up another Rumble channel just for this these broadcasts here. So we got a lot of stuff to talk about, guys. And so, but 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, continuing obviously off of chapter 2. So Paul goes on and says, "Wherefore, when we could no longer forbear, we thought it good to be left at Athens alone." And again, continue off of chapter 2. "And sent Timothy, our brother and minister of God, and our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ to establish you and to comfort you concerning you, your faith." So establish means to fulfill. That's why when Jesus says, "I'm not here to abolish the law, I'm here to fulfill it." Fulfill means establish. Establish means to fulfill. It means you continue, establish, right? So anyway, he's talking about Timothy, his minister of God, he's a laborer, a fellow laborer. In other words, he works in the ministry, in the gospel of Christ, to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith. So Timothy, he said, you know, sent Timothy to the Thessalonians to help them, with their faith and everything, right? So that no man should be moved by these afflictions. And for yourselves know that we are appointed thereunto. So we like to do Bible studies here. So afflictions, I want to get a clear understanding for you. Afflictions. And you always want the Bible meaning. Yeah, very important. You have to keep repeating that. So when you look up a word, look up the Bible meaning. Because the regular meaning today could be a lot different from back then. So it's a state of pain, distress, and grief that can cause by physical infirmity or mental distress. So that's what afflictions are. Something that's causing us pain, distress, grief. Which sin does that big time, guys. Sin does that big time. So, for verily, when we were with you, we told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass, you know. So, Paul's saying you got to suffer tribulation. And that's, boils over into today's world when, the modern dispensationalist church is out there. And I want to point out, dispensationalism in the church says is not the same dispensation as the Bible. I need to point that out, right? So, in the modern day dispensational church will teach you, there's a pre-tribulation rapture. We're already here before the rapture happens, right? I'm sorry, the tribulation. No. The founding fathers, the early church fathers, they talked about going through tribulation and the end times. For us, that we're going to go through tribulation. So is in the apostles. There's no way in the scripture that says we're going to be magically beamed up out of here before the bad stuff happens. And Paul said, and the thing is too, if God didn't spare the apostles from tribulation, what makes you think he's going to spare you? We did tons of shows on that. So, yeah. Again, Paul says, for verily, which is I want to point that out too, because that's spoken in the Bible a lot. Verily, it's like a Hebrew word meaning, means so be it. Truly, verily means truly, this is words of my truth. Like you hear Jesus say it all the time, right? Verily, I say unto you. Truthfully, I say unto you. That's what it means. When we were with you, this is Paul sending Timothy with this letter. But telling them, hey, listen, remember when we were with you? This is truthfully I'm talking to you. We told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass, and you know. So if you think for 1 minute, all right, you're not going to suffer tribulation. We all did. We still do. Here and there. And that means you're doing your job. Because remember when Stephen was killed, the apostle that replaced Judas, when they went to deliver him up for death, he was excited about it because he knew he was doing his job for the Lord. For this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I sent to you your faith. Lest by some means the tempter have tempted you, and our labor be in vain. So who's the tempter? As we know, the tempter in the scripture was, we clearly say, it's Satan. Because he tried to tempt Jesus, tried to tempt Jesus. And Jesus told him, hey, for it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Right? So, who's the tempter is clearly Satan, has tempted you. And our labor be in vain. So it means all the work you've done will be for nothing. Again, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, and I think that means work here, so... Forbear in the Bible means abstain or hold back. So Paul says, when I can no longer sustain or hold back, I sent to you, to you know your faith. Lest you, by some means, the tempter, or Satan, has tempted you, and our labor be in vain. So all the work you've done, if you get tempted by Satan, everything you've done for the Lord is in vain. If you allowed Satan to tempt you, you know. But now, when Timothy came from you unto us and brought us good tidings of your faith and charity, good tidings is like basically a good report of your faith and charity, and you have good remembrance of us always, desiring greatly to see us, we also to see you. Now, if you understand what's going on here, this is Paul in prison writing these letters to these churches. That's why he can't be here. So therefore, brethren, we were comforted over you in all our afflictions and distressed by your faith. And in distress by your faith. So he's distressed because people lose their faith. As you can see through the Corinthians and all that stuff, right? The Romans, the Thessalonians, yeah. The Galatians. For now we live, if you stand fast in the Lord. Stand fast is to hold your ground. Let me just get a double. Stand fast, meaning. It's a phrase that in the Bible means several different contexts. So, to be stationary and preserve. Don't move an inch. Don't change your course. So, yeah, hold your ground. Don't be shaken off your course. I mean, if you're doing something for the Lord, stand fast. No matter what the devil throws at you. Keep enduring through it. And by the way, if you're new to this, and again, we say this all the time, don't ever be afraid to ask what the meaning of a word is in the Bible. This is what a Bible study is. If somebody's holding the Bible study, you don't know what a word means, you stop them right there and ask them. And if he or her doesn't want to do that, tell them don't continue. Because if you don't know what a word means, it can really hinder the complete understanding of the scripture. That one word. So this is why it's important to know, even if you question it. It's like, I kind of know. Don't kind of know. Yes and no. Kind of know means no. You don't really know what it means. I have to tell myself that all the time. And so go look it up. Don't be afraid or ashamed that people are going to think I'm dumb or something because I'm trying to look up a word that everybody should know. No, that's what a Bible study is. So you get the full concept of what they're talking about. Verse 9. For what thanks can we render to God again for you? For all the joy wherewith we joy for your sake before our God. Render to God, right, is to give again for you. And with all the joy wherewith we joy for your sakes before our God. So as you know, the scripture show too, and especially in the Galatians a lot, that you're supposed to do this with joy. Don't let it be a burden to you. And Paul made this very clear in several of his books there, that when he labors for the Lord, that means do the work of the Lord, right? Don't let it be, oh man, I got to do this. Like, don't be, you know, like as if it's a regular job or something that you're like, ugh, I just got to get through the day. Yeah, no, do it with gladness and joy. And if you come to that point where, like, oh man, this is just getting too much, take a break. That's why the Lord gives us the Sabbath to rest. Take a break. Okay, if you're getting overwhelmed, overworked, whatever, take a break. That's why we're supposed to rest. But when you do this, do it with joy. And it's an honor to do this. It really is. It's a complete honor to bring the Word of God to people. And Paul says, verse 10, night and day praying exceedingly, that means nonstop, that we might see your face and might perfect that which is lacking in your faith. So Paul is concerned to the Thessalonians, saying, listen, it's like, yeah, we're praying for you all the time. And we want to help you perfect which is lacking in your faith. So in today's world with us, right, what is lacking in your faith? Ask yourself right now. Because it's no different from then and now what we're going through in the church. The church is we, the body of the people, not a religion or denomination or a building. All of us listening right now, we're the church. So ask yourself right now, what are you lacking in faith? Some people have complete courage in the Lord, and then they lack in faith in the Lord helping them in other ways. So pray to the Holy Spirit to help you. And there's nothing wrong with talking to a brother or sister about what you're lacking. But pray for the Holy Spirit to help build that faith in that area that you're lacking. So now God himself and our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ direct our way unto you. So Paul's being led by the Spirit to write this letter to him, the Thessalonians. It looks like a short chapter, 13 verses. So, and the Lord make you increase, right, and abound in love one toward another, and toward all men, even as we do toward you. So that's very important, right? The first great commandment, love your neighbors, you love yourself, right? The definition of love is pure, is God, plain and simple. I know in the dictionaries they have different meanings, whatever, but the definitions, but the real definition of love is God. Without God, there's no love. Especially when he sent his only begotten son to die for us, that you don't get any greater love than that. And as Jesus says, right, it is written, what greater love than it is for a man to give him, literally die for his brother. And I'll give you an example, right? Just say in Vietnam, there was a lot of cases when a grenade got thrown. And to save the whole squad, one of the guys would just jump on a grenade, like land on, he would get killed doing it. But knowing that he's going to save the lives of his people around him. What greater love is that? For you to die for your brother. So God came in the flesh as a son of a man, the son of God, to die for us, to let us execute him. That there's no greater love than that. So again, though, and the Lord make you increase and abound in love toward one another. So even love your enemies. Again, toward all men, love to all men. That's men and women. That's what that means. Because mankind means men and women. So, just in case people think it's sexist. No, it's all people. Even as we do toward you. To the end, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God. Even our Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all the saints. So very important to understand. Just love your neighbor. Golden rule, right? And again, to end that he may establish your hearts unblameable. So when you love one another, right, you establish your heart and it's unblameable and holiness before God. When you're in a spirit, right, you're unblameable. Because Jesus says to be held blameless. Even if somebody wrongly convicts you for something or accuses you, if you know you haven't done it, okay, it doesn't matter what a worldly judge would say, you know you can stand before the Creator and say, yeah, God, I didn't do that, and God knows that. Jesus says, right, it's written, it'll be held blameless. Even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all the saints. So this is a short chapter here. I like to take my time doing these Bible studies. That's why some of these videos will go on for an hour or something. but I don't hold no certain time limit because I think to do that, you're going to limit what the scripture has to offer. And I'm sure you could pull out more meat and potatoes, I call it, more context out of this. And if you got any more context, please put it in the comment section. Because we could read this one chapter 100 times And it's only when, and only when, okay, when the Holy Spirit decides that you're ready to be revealed the information he wants to give you. I'll give you an example, right? I say this all the time. When I read Genesis chapter 1, I don't know how many times I read that chapter, right? And listened to it, read it. And it didn't, it took years for it to occur to me that the earth was created first, because everything we learned in the schools, the dumbed down education system, that the soul is, you know, the Big Bang and, you know, the Jesuit lie, it's false, right? All this happened and eventually the earth was formed, but the Bible says the complete opposite. The earth was first 4 days before the sun, moon, and stars. It took a while for that to sink in. So this is why we have to do these scriptures nonstop. And when I get done with the Bible here, I think I'm probably going to run through it again. You do an updated version of this. Because here's the thing. When you go through the scriptures, the more you know, because it correlates with other chapters. It correlates to other books. There's like 66,000 parallels and correlations from the Old to the New and New to the Old Testament. That's why if any church out there tells you, just read Matthew to Revelation, no. You tell them you need to read the whole thing. Because as you've seen so far, we started from Matthew, right? I should have started from Genesis, but my bad on that. But how many times does Jesus say, as it is written? How many times does Paul say, as it is written? What are they talking about? As is what? Which written? It's the Torah. It's the Old Testament. So if you don't know the Torah and the Old Testament, you're not going to understand what they're saying. And that's these modern-day churches that they say that. Oh, just read the New Testament. Don't worry about the Old. It's not important. Really? Because what do you think they're talking about? They're reciting and talking about the Old Testament and the Torah. Yeah, and the Torah, as you know, is the first 5 books of the Old Testament. The books of Moses. So this is why it's important to know and understand the entire Bible. Because when you could draw 66,000 plus parallels from old to new and new to old, that's unreal. Not even the best authors in the world, if they all got together, they couldn't even pull something off like that. That's how we know this is the Word of God. So guys, thank you for joining me. And don't take my word or anybody else's word for it. Read it for yourself. Plain and simple. And if you want to contact me for any reason, truthradioshow@outlook.com. If you need a prayer request, please do so. And if you want it public or not, most of the time I just keep it. I've been doing that, but I'm just keeping it private. You know what I mean? So just specify you want to keep it private. You know what I mean? If you, whatever the prayer request you need or whatever the case, just specify it. Just keep this private. So because I, you know, get prayer requests from people that just want to, they don't want it public, whatever. And the only time I do make it public is sometimes I'll do prayer requests on shows, which I should start doing again soon. I haven't done it in a while. But regardless, unless you tell me that it's going to stay private. You know what I mean? So, yeah, truthradioshowoutlook.com and go to truthradioshow.com for our local listings of our Spiritual Warfare Friday shows, breaking NWO news show, documentaries, and my Bible study shows here. So, anyway, thank you for tuning into the book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter 3. We'll see you for chapter 4 soon. So, God bless, shalom, and you are the resistance.